Welcome to the video. We continue on with our essential investigation into this new paradigm, this new explanation for that accounts for our situation. That is, we're trying to make, have been working on, an alternative reality, as it were, for the purpose of convincing our potential future offspring that this is where they came from and they didn't come from us, that they were manufactured by this process from time and space. So we have been preparing for our hope for potential offspring, creating separately from God so we can be claimed to be prime creator. We've been preparing this scenario with past to be, we've been working on it for so long, and the purpose again is for our offspring to be convinced that they came from this and not from us. This is that the new creation will be creation of separation, where the what is created feels that it didn't come from what created it. So we've been trying to make it so convincing that our offspring would say, no, we didn't come from spirit, we came from matter and energy and matter, that we ourselves have forgotten where we came from. It's because we're so intensely involved in this effort to fashion this incredible deception that we've ended up deceiving ourselves and we've forgotten where we came from. This is the real problem. And so if we can investigate this and look at it, we may see how easy it is to resolve. Since this world is for no one, actually, no one at all, and it's only causing us this, our forgetfulness, and we have no choice but to remember reality, because we will never be a new prime creator. We don't have any offspring. Projections are not creation. So all of this is for nothing. All of this is for nothing at all. Therefore, we have no choice but to remember reality. But how do we remember reality when we ourselves seem to be immersed in this totally fake life, fake source, total fake source? All this is fake source, projected source, it's fake. And so how do we remember? That's the question. And we shift to the vertical. We shift our perception to the vertical. We see the oneness. We allow the oneness to be seen, meaning everything is one and the same in its relationship to omnipresence. Okay, so this is our basic investigation at this point, seeing what the paradigm really is, what the situation really is, that in our attempts to fool our offspring, we fool ourselves. The remedy comes when we realize we don't have any offspring separate from God. So all of this stuff is for really nothing at all. And so how do we be reminded of reality at this point then? By, instead of having our attention and perception engrossed with the deception of time and space, we see the timeless, baseless relationship. A relationship which is not based on time and space and appearances and locations and movement in time and space. We see the one fundamental, the one relationship, the only relationship that there is, which is everything equally, right now, always, as the one relationship with omnipresence, with God. And this is how we then come out of our spell. In an attempt to weave a spell for our offspring, we ourselves have become spellbound. See, this is the humor, the joke of it all. We've joked ourselves, really. And when we can, the more we can recognize this, I believe it, the easier it's going to get. So we can say, today I see the one. Today I see the one. I had a dream last night. There was this big screen television set, and it kept shifting from one picture to another, and being blocked and then unblocked, blocked and unblocked. There was a struck battle for the control of the television, what was being shown on the television screen. And I was trying to make it show what I wanted to show, and it kept trying to go back, flip back to something else. I said, no, that's not what I want to see. So he would say, today I see only the one. Today I see only the one. Today I see only the one. Which reminds me of non-projection, which reminds me of reality. Now, of course, in reality, we're not obsessed with trying to fashion delusion. There's no motive for that. So all of these fragmentary appearances of, you know, temporary fragmentary appearances is not something that we're would be indulging in. But since we're used to all this, we just keep all of this the way that it is. But see the one relationship that is omnipresent. See the omnipresent one relationship. The one relationship everything has right now with omnipresence. And that's all we need to do. Just that slight vertical shift. We go vertical. Today I go vertical. Today I go vertical. I should be wearing my Air Jordans today, except I don't have any anymore. That was the 90s. But today I go vertical. Today I go vertical. Today I see vertical. Today I experience vertical. Today I'm aware of the vertical. Today I am aware of the vertical. Today I am conscious of the vertical. As the only relationship there is. I read that Sri Nisargadatta said, you can either be on one side of a wall or the other side of the wall. You know, you can't be both unless you get rid of the wall. But for our purposes, the wall is all this form and shape and location. So we're either seeing the horizontal, deceptive, relative relationship of location and quality in relation to other location, other quality, or we see the vertical relationship, the one true relationship, which everything shares, all shares, everything is it. We cannot emphasize both of those. One has to be the primary, because each one is denying the other, actually. So today we see the one relationship. We go vertical. We see, we're aware. Today I am aware of the one relationship with omnipresence. And of course it'll be flopping back and forth like in the dream, the television set. First it presented this, then this, kept going back and forth. So in other words, I'm struggling, trying to change the channel, as it were, change what's being presented on the television screen of my mind. I want to see just the one relationship with omnipresence. And then you know that's an unchanging relationship. It's an unchanging relationship. So all the changes in location of all appearances doesn't affect it in the slightest bit. Totally unaffected by that. And then we feel like we have a steady, stable experience. Which is something that we hardly can even imagine, really. So today I go vertical. Today I see the one. Today I see the one. And only the one. not trying to establish some other relationship independent of one relationship, which we'd be only doing for the sake of our offspring to deceive them, and we don't have any offspring separate from the will of God. So all that's happening is we're deceiving ourselves. You know, that's the kicker of the whole thing. We thought it was we're doing it for something else, but we ended up only deceiving ourselves. And it's an unnecessary deception, totally unnecessary deception. So our will, gathering our will, in spite of, we're obviously aware that we're ambivalent, like the dream, switching back and forth. So okay, there's ambivalence there. Don't worry about the ambivalence. Just continue to gather your will and assert that today I go vertical. Today I see only the one. I see the one. Today I see the one. And you'll feel unsteady. You'll feel uncertain. Like, oh, I'm not sure. And just say, okay, we'll smooth it out. Today I'm emphasizing the vertical aspect. Let's try that. Today I emphasize the vertical relationship with omnipresence. Let's make it a little easier. Instead of saying it just has to be only that, let's just say we're emphasizing it today. Today my attention is on the vertical relationship. Keep in mind that all the horizontal relative relationship, it was all been crafted by us to get our offspring to overlook the vertical. So we have been believing that this is possible. So we're assuming that the horizontal is more attractive than the vertical, way more attractive. But this again is only an expression of our desire that our offspring not know what created it. It doesn't reflect fact at all. Okay, so this is important to look at this. Huge assumption we have that it must be, we think that this, it must be form and shape and the relative relationship of that, what we're sensory perception, must be way more attractive than the vertical relationship with omnipresence. We believe it because we desire it. We desire it because we want to be prime creator. And the way that we want to be prime, the way to be prime creator is create differently than God creates, create offspring that is separate from us. Doesn't recognize us as creating them. So in order to do that, they cannot recognize the omnipresence. So we've tried to fashion something we feel is more attractive, an alternative relationship of form relating to form, flesh to flesh, energy to energy. And so we believe that this is more attractive, it's better. That no offspring of us would even be the slightest bit interested in seeing this relation to omnipresence, because this is so much better. So of course we believe that, because that's what we want our offspring to believe. It's kind of like true believers, we want something to be so we assume it is so. But is it actually so? Is it really more attractive than the one relationship to omnipresence? Is it really more attractive? It's totally unstable, right? It's totally vulnerable. You know, you can go on and on and on. Is it really more attractive? But first we need to realize why we think it is more attractive. Because we want our offspring to be convinced it is. So we've put our conviction into it, trying to test out and see. You know, it's kind of like these bodies. I think these, you know, the way I look at bodies and incarnation is we're putting test probes into this world that we have made, testing it out and getting feedback from that. And so we're checking to see what do these bodies enjoy? How can we make it better for these bodies? What areas of the bodies, what are the weaknesses where the body, we're starting to feel like the body might be thinking about vertical, or the spirit might be thinking about vertical. So all these bodies are really test runs for our offspring. They're not our offspring. They're trial balloons, as it were, being put into this world of time and space, in this situation, in the dream of time and space. And we're observing them, we're witnessing, we're observing, we're noticing the reactions as if they were our offspring, but they're not. They're kind of like test rats to determine what the effect is going to be on the offspring. We're looks like a laboratory, and we're like laboratory rats. The bodies, body minds are like laboratory rats that we're using. And so we wander, bodies wander the world, and they do this and they do that, and spirit notes them and says, okay, how can we improve the experience here to so that it's totally forgetful of omnipresence. Now this is it's a little ragged explanation, but you have to start out ragged. You start out with some cloth, and then you tailor the cloth into a suit of clothes. So this is also a new way of looking at bodies, incarnation, etc. Very much so. And to me, it's accurate, just the explanation needs to be smoothed out. It's like a trial run, a simulation. It's like a simulation, using the body to get some idea of how our offspring might react, and how to give answers, and how to shape things, and how to keep the delusion, you know, ultimately super strong. And so the spirit uses bodies, and the spirit will use bodies. Say, well, what? Maybe I'm not so happy about this, and then they say, okay, but how do I steer the mind back into being happy with it? You know, it just uses the body mind. It just uses the body mind. Wow. And of course, it tells the body mind that it is a separate entity, but it's not. It's not. It's a trial run in preparation for what the spirit believes will be a separate entity here. Yeah, so we're getting hotter and hotter and hotter here with the explanation. Spirit, bodies are just a projection, like everything here, but it's a projection that spirit uses to test out the stability of projection. Can it remain? How stable can it remain, so that it does not so the source is not remembered of the projection? So bodies really are being controlled by spirit. But the reactivity of bodies is being looked at to see if it's possible that the reactivity of the body can somehow become separate, you know, become a separate entity from a projection. That's again a ragged explanation, but I'm seeing it. So the reactivity of the body is what is not needed anymore when spirit recognizes this world, this universe, not to test it out, to see how our offspring might react to it, and if it reacts. So we don't need these reactive mechanisms we call body. Bodies are just reactive mechanisms, actually. They're not our they're not a self or anything. It's in preparation. They're just these reactive probes we're putting into this environment to see how will we react? How will potential, how will our offspring react? Sort of modeling it, simulating it. A totally reactive being that is unaware of its being. You know, they're simply reacting to stimuli and stuff. We don't need a reactive body. We don't need a reactivity. So we see the vertical, there's no more reactivity. We're not reacting to our reactivity of the body is muted. Because we're not seeing any meaning in relative relationship of, you know, you have a different location relative to my location, and that has some meaning. Whereas in omnipresence, that has no meaning. There's no such thing as a different location in omnipresence. So the reactivity of the body goes down. That's what's called the peace beyond understanding. It's a different kind of peace than what we think of, which is relative peace. Well, I live in a peaceful place, and I see a peaceful day. I feel kind of content with my life. I have money, and I feel, you know, I sort of feel peaceful. Have a nice kitchen, have some good food, nice car. This is a peace beyond that. It's the actual muting of all reactivity to react to relative relationship. You see the one relationship, which is non-reactive. There's no reactive where it's more here and less there. It's all equal. Again, we don't need the reactivity. That's all just data that we're gathering. Just data that we're gathering that so that to help us better fashion a past in a time-space scenario where our proposed offspring, our hope for offspring, will not relate to omnipresence at all. We'll have no idea about it. It would be simply totally reactive, not even know its creator. It's all just data. All these bodies are just collecting data. They have no other purpose, actually. Which is why, you know, we're bodies just don't do it for us as spirit at all, do they? No, not at all. It's just data collection. We know it. And we're tired of bodies. We want the offspring, you know, but there won't be any. There isn't any offspring of the desire to create separately from God's will. False pregnancy. So we don't need to collect any data of relative relationship. We don't need to collect any data. Zero data is needed. What data do we need to collect in order to work on the impossible? What can never happen? What data is relevant? What relevant data can we collect? None. Data collection is irrelevant. That's right. I just said it. Data collection is irrelevant. Totally irrelevant. There's two levels of hearing that. One, I can feel it deep down. I feel this some sort of reverberation. Very powerful. And then the other that has only faintly suggested itself is to argue with it and say, now wait a minute, let's look at every possible facet of data collection. I said, no. See, because I intuitively know this is absolutely true. Data collection is totally irrelevant. The one relationship, omnipresent, is already present, eternally present, always. There's no need for any data on that whatsoever. Our attempt to fool our offspring is completely irrelevant. We don't need to collect any data of how to accomplish the impossible. So it's totally irrelevant, totally meaningless. Data collection is totally meaningless. Now, people may say, well, it's impossible to assert this in a world which is completely obsessed with data collection. No, it's not impossible. I'm just doing it right now. I'm living in the heart of Silicon Valley, which is the heart of the obsession with data collection. I'm able to say data collection is totally irrelevant. So if I can do it here, anyone can do it anywhere. Anyone can assert this. Data collection is totally irrelevant. This is a tremendously freeing realization. And my mind is not disagreeing with that at all. It's not arguing, not at all. Data collection is totally irrelevant. Data collection is totally irrelevant. Now, what is the benefit of looking at this? Well, when you realize that you can accept this assertion without freaking out, then you're really close to the vision of oneness. Where you won't be collecting data. See? So first we have to accept that data collection is irrelevant. Then when the vision of oneness arises, we'll say, oh, okay, yes, that's fine. There won't be any collecting any data. This body will no longer be engaged in collecting any data at all. Nothing that happens is interpreted as data. Because only the one relationship is being seen that's already perfect, always present, data free. Data collection is totally irrelevant. Everybody claims that, you know, they just can't get it done. But I'm saying that's not true. Even in the greatest seeming trap of obsession with data collection, absolutely can turn it around. So I've lived my entire life in the Silicon Valley with just the complete obsession here of data collection from just virtually everyone, and been able to turn it around even in those circumstances, even though it's difficult. So I know that the idea that we're so lost we can never be redeemed is false. Absolutely false. Absolutely false. The most you can say of anyone is that they're so obsessed with data collection that it will take them a while to turn it around, for sure. They may need to go through all sorts of cycles they may go back into a primitive cycle, which of course they'll rebuild civilization because they're so obsessed with data collection. That they'll start measuring, analyzing, computing, data collecting, everything. But as you do that over and over, you get tired and tired and tired of it. And then eventually you might start listening to the Holy Spirit at some point. It may take time, I understand that. But the whole principle is seen here. So it's not like truth vanishes when you're obsessed with data collection. It's still all the truth, the whole situation remains exactly the same. It's not absent at all. The one relationship is not absent in the slightest bit. The self-deception is not absent. That's what's happening. And the cause of all this has not changed in the slightest bit. It's just that our desire to deceive our offspring is still very strong. We haven't realized we cannot produce separate from God. So the ignorance is the same. The defensiveness is the same. The remedy is the same. Everything is the same. It doesn't change at all, anywhere. So it doesn't matter, you know, where anyone goes or what anyone's doing. It's all the same. There's no data that needs to be collected on it. Truth is true. But I see that the obsessions that people have with how they keep themselves, you know, they're working so much for their offspring, spirit feels that it just hasn't done enough. Once it just has to try harder, and then the deception will be so complete that then that'll cause the offspring to be born. Once it's complete, it'll automatically trigger the birth of it. It'll never happen. But people do, minds do, spirit does work so hard at this and so dedicated to it, all for naught. And you know, certainly there's a time when you go through this disillusionment, which is very painful because you fail, you feel like you're a failure. Well, of course, see, it's not a failure. Trying to do the impossible is not a failure. It's a whim, it's a joke. Trying to set the model for our offspring with using these bodies. Excuse me. We'll tell our offspring, yes, you're impermanent. So it won't be reminded of, you know, eternal life. You say you're impermanent life. And so you have to keep replacing yourself. See, impermanent life, you have to keep replacing yourself. See, look at the model of these bodies, human bodies, and all these life forms of replication. This is where you came from. So, of course, bodies age and die. Everything ages and dies. This is all by design to convince our offspring that it's not eternal life. Otherwise, it would realize its source. See, but there isn't going to be any offspring because there is no source separate from the will of God. So we cannot create separate from the will of God. And the will of God is that all creation is an extension of the will of God. It is not some separate will. So I have no choice. None of us have any choice. I have no choice but to see the vertical. I have no choice but to see the one relationship. I have no choice but to see the one relationship. No choice whatsoever. To delaying is not a choosing something else. It's just a sulking and a continuity fear, just a continuity fear, but it's not a choosing of something else. It's not. We don't have anything else to choose from. We don't have anything else to choose from. All this data collection is totally irrelevant. It's not an option. It's not a choice. It's just a delay. There's a delay in recognizing that we don't have any choice. We cannot create a separate creation. So we can't choose that option. There isn't any option for us, so we don't have a choice. So today I accept I don't have any choice. I must see the one relationship. I must see the one. I must do the vertical shift. Shift vertically. I must let the one relationship shine upon, the holy relationship shine upon my perception. I must allow the one holy relationship to shine upon my perception. I don't have any choice. There's another potent data. All data collection is totally irrelevant. I don't have any choice but to see the one, the holy relationship, to allow the holy relationship to shine upon my awareness. Don't have any choice. No one has any choice. This is the only choice there is. So it's not even a choice, but I guess you can say the one choice we have is to allow the holy oneness to shine upon our perception. So we're keeping our perception, as it were. So you could say that's the one option we do have. It's the only one, though. This is the only option I have to choose, because reality is not a choice. It's complete imperative. But God says, okay, here's an intermediate step. You can choose. I don't have any choice but to go vertical. That is true. I have no choice but to go vertical. It's the only choice I have. Data collection is totally irrelevant. Now we can give this time because it's super important what we're doing. It's more important than anything in the world, than any of the data collection that's taking place. Totally more important, incomparably more important. So to spend a little time with this is totally justified. To not be in a hurry and rush off and say, okay, I gotta rush off now and collect more data. Now, it's interesting at this time, I don't have any work, so I'm able to spend this time, you know, with this huge push right now. So it's all a blessing in disguise. It's all a blessing in disguise, actually. Maybe you don't have a lot of work. You know, maybe you don't have a lot of work. You have some time. That's a blessing in disguise. You may be thinking, oh, it's terrible. I'm not able to collect enough data. It's a blessing in disguise. Data collection is totally irrelevant. All data collection is totally irrelevant. Being heretical or blasphemous to self-deception is our responsibility, isn't it? In an attempt to dupe our offspring, we've duped ourselves. That's the funny thing. We've duped ourselves. We think we've come from here now. Because that's what we want our offspring to believe, so this is what we receive for ourselves. We're convinced it's possible. Therefore, we believe that our offspring. Our offspring's not even here. It doesn't even exist. So, Yeah, we're the ones that are they're duped now. But we know that no, this is not true. None of this is true. But we're thinking, hey, if we can dupe ourselves, we should be able to dupe our offspring, right? So we're really duping ourselves as a way to convince ourselves that our offspring are going to be duped, all right? And concocting this past for our offspring to see where it came from, all this. But the whole deception is easily lifted off of us by simply going vertical and seeing the one relationship with everything, and everything is it. There's just one relationship, and everything is it. All data collection is totally irrelevant. Yeah. There's just one omnipresent relationship, and everything is it. And all data collection is totally irrelevant. And just let that intuitively be soaked up. Soak it up intuitively. Don't try to soak it up mentally or intellectually. Don't ever try to soak it up something up intellectually. Because then your data collecting. You're evaluating the data. Don't evaluate the data. Soak it up intuitively. It's a different feeling. It doesn't feel like your head is being involved in it. You know, you're not trying to. It's more like your organism as a whole, as it is. It's sort of like deactivating of the data collection obsession somehow in your system. Not in a negative way, it's some sort of muting, or some sort of muting of importance of it, where you're getting ready to see, to experience, to be aware of the holiness, vision of holiness, without any reaction as far as collecting data from it, trying to collect data from it. Of course, that would drive you crazy if you try to collect data from it, which is why we don't see it. We have to drop this obsession with collecting data. It's meaningless. So the vision of oneness, there isn't any meaningful data to collect at all, none. We equate data collecting with value, don't we? There's no value to data collection. Again, soak this up intuitively, not intellectually. The intellect is all about relativism, duality, and it will argue and take both sides. It'll establish two sides so it can then collect data of the interaction and try to generate value that way. Just soak it up intuitively. Not emotionally, that's another data thing, intuitively. There's no emotion really involved, that we're involved with the vision of oneness, that there's peace beyond understanding, peace beyond emotion, beyond intellect. There's no data collection, so you're not missing anything. Not deprived of any information. So it's a kind of spiritual relief. The great relief, you might call it. The great relief that emotions can never reach. Intellect can never reach that. The peaceful relief. I don't need to collect any data. I'm free of this obsession to collect any data whatsoever. It doesn't matter what's happening, because nothing's happening with this relationship. It's totally steady and stable. There isn't any data being generated relative to this relationship, the one relationship, and everything is it, as it is. So there isn't any data being generated. So I'm not missing anything. I don't need to add anything to it either. I'm not delinquent in any way. no to zero delinquency. I'm a zero delinquent, no delinquency. There's even no happiness data to collect. There's no data of any kind. So the whole notion of I'm insufficient, I'm inadequate, I need to do more, gone. So it's a great, I would say, it would be a tremendous relief. The way to proceed along the path is intuitively. And so whatever you can soak up intuitively, soak it up. And try not to engage the intellect and the emotions. And each one of us has a challenge. If we're more polarized towards the intellect, we have to be very careful not to engage the intellect. If we're more polarized towards the emotions, we have to be very careful not to engage the emotions. Both are just ways of data collecting. And you can euphemize this and say, well, it's this or it's that, and put nice sounding words around it, but there's something deeper, that spirit, intuition, spiritual intuition, not human intuition, spiritual intuition is different. Spiritual intuition knows and says, yeah, this is true. It doesn't argue, it soaks it up. So try to absorb as much as possible intuitively, with spiritual intuition. Spiritual intuition doesn't demand details. That's data. See, we're waking up to remember who we really are, what we really are, spirit. The one relationship doesn't demand any details or data. It doesn't demand any data. It's already totally, perfectly established. Irretrievably established. Endlessly established. It doesn't need any data. Our particulars or details to determine anything about what it is. So you may experience it. Spiritual intuition soaking it up is a feeling just like, wow. And you just breathe it like, wow. There's something very deep that is somehow responding to this. Beneath the mind, the intellect, beneath the emotions, there's something that is relating to this and soaking it up. All right, keep soaking it up. Very great. That's it.